And I will introduce you guys. Okay. Welcome, everyone. My name is Lucy Gray, and I am the instructor for National Lewis University's Technology and Education course number 575, which is focused on staff development. And we are joined by two professional development experts tonight as guest speakers, and we're thrilled to have them. The point of this speaker series is to bring in the outside to my students and connect them to some people who've been working in this space. And hopefully this work will inspire people in my class with their benchmark projects, which are due at the end of the course around middle of March. And last week we had Peggy George from Arizona, who is the online guru of everything. If there's an online event, she's there. And we also had Sylvia Talisano, who has been a teacher and a consultant and is doing a lot of work with visible learning. And she was amazing. So in my YouTube channel, that recording is there. And this recording will also be up there when we're done. So if you're interested in these sort of things, make sure you take a look at their presentations. They were really fabulous. So tonight we have Dr. Harrison McCoy, who has been involved with my global education conference stuff. And he is in the Arlington Independent School District in Texas, which I'm assuming is near Dallas, Harrison?
Yes, it is. We're just about halfway between Dallas and Fort Worth.
Okay. And you're calling in tonight from the TCEA, from the Texas Computing Educators Association Conference, correct?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Yes, I'm actually in Austin tonight, so.
Oh, great. So maybe you'll tell us a little bit about that as well. We are also joined by Dr. Julie Keane from Participate Learning, and I've known Julie for a couple years now. We first worked together on a project through Columbia College called the Convergence Academies, and then her B Corp that she works for has been really supportive of the Global Education Conference that I run online, which Irene and Matthew may not be familiar with, and I'll give you a link to that. And Participate has been they just rebranded, and it used to be called VIF International Education. And I'll let Julie, do you want to tell us a few seconds about what VIF does or Participate does?
Yeah, so we sort of join forces. So our Participate in its new incarnation is really a company that is 30 years old. So the first sort of phase of our history was really bringing in international teachers to teach in K-12 schools nationally, and then now we're targeted mostly in the Southeast. And so we were very active in the global education space, mainly driven by the bicultural and international expertise of our foreign teachers who had come from, or international teachers who had come from 50 countries and are still now part of our online community, and then started to develop professional development, again, based on their expertise, and developed various platforms. And then we were lucky to be introduced, actually through Lucy, all roads lead to Lucy Gray, to Participate. That was really a very exciting open platform that I'll talk about in more detail later on. But we really thought that they really had the kind of platform, the kind of open tools that can really drive participatory learning. And they were called Participate, so it was really great. So that's why we just sort of changed our name, really just in the last month. And so we do the international teachers, we have a platform, and we also do kind of school transformation work directly with schools, and then additionally with just having a platform that's open for teachers to drive their own learning.
So all of my students last week had to create a collection.
And oh, great. Okay, fantastic.
I forced them to take a look at it.
And, oh, fantastic.
And what I think is really interesting about it is they all created really, somebody might want to mute. I hear some noise in the background. If you're not muted, you may want to mute. They had to, maybe it's muted. Anyway, they had to create resources around change management and innovation. And really good collections. I was really excited to see what they came up with.
Okay, great. Oh, that's awesome. So they have some background. Great.
Yeah. So we've been talking a little bit about adult learning, principles of adult learning, technology integration models. We talked about SAMR and CBAM and that sort of thing a little bit. And then we've been talking about change management, how can technology initiatives change cultures of schools and things like that. And so this week and next week, we're really exploring online learning and what the opportunities are out there. So we've asked them to follow a MOOC or some sort of other online learning event in order to kind of get involved with that. And some of the teachers are experienced with this stuff already, some are not, some are just dipping their toe in. And I'm hoping that they'll find something that's really kind of personalized to them, that they'll find valuable to take after the class. We have three students with us. I'm really excited to see. We have Irene, Kelly, and Matthew. And Irene, Kelly, and Matthew, feel free to jump in at any point, ask questions in the chat, share resources, whatever you want to do. We're really happy to have you here. I'm really excited because this is the first time I've met some of my students. So we're thrilled to have you here.
No, I'm too.
I hear somebody. Is that you, Kelly?
I say no, I beg you.
Hello.
Hi, Kelly.
So I have a TV in the background. Sounds
yeah. Hi. Yeah, I'm going to mute you, Kelly, because I think it might be your TV in the background.
Okay.
if I can figure out how to mute you, but I may not be able to.
I can mute me.
Okay, you can mute you. Good. Thank you, Kelly. I don't mean to make you mute, but jump in whenever you want to. I'm going to turn this over to Harrison and let him tell us a story, let him tell us about what's going on in Texas, what's going on at TCEA, which may be of interest to you. And you can follow TCEA too on a hashtag, by the way, and maybe he can tell us a little bit more about that. So without further ado, take it away, Harrison.
Okay, thank you. Yes, live from Austin, Texas. the Texas Computer Educators Association is a really, it is a Texas conference, but I think it draws from surrounding states as well. And this week in Austin, we have probably between 5,000 and 6,000 teachers or school administrators here. And we're getting to take advantage of some really innovative conferences and training. We also have a large convention center of vendors that opened up this afternoon, and we're getting to see some of the most incredible cutting-edge technology that's available right now. It's probably 2 football fields big. It will take me all 3 days, just part of the day, to wander through it and experience some of that. I teach in Arlington, Texas, which, as I said, is about halfway between Dallas and Fort Worth, where I guess we would be called a suburban community, not extremely urban, but ethnically very, very diverse. I teach at a high school that's kind of unique. It's called an early college high school, and that means that our students work simultaneously toward their high school diploma and their associate's degree at a community college. And we're actually in a building on the community college campus. Our ninth graders begin taking college classes during their ninth grade year. They continue with their high school core classes and add to the college courses in their sophomore year. And then when they move into the 11th grade, all of their coursework is dual credit, and it's on the actual college campus. So they're totally immersed in the college environment at about age 16. And the goal is that they will finish with both degrees at the same time. And we have our third cohort right now. We only have 9th, 10th, and 11th grade. And it's kind of a wonderful school and a wonderful concept and a great opportunity that targets at-risk students primarily and first-generation college students as an opportunity to give them a leg up and an advantage toward getting a full 4-year degree. And we're just kind of excited about that. We're recruiting or interviewing for our fourth cohort, which means next year we'll have our first graduation class. I wanted to talk a little bit about how professional learning has changed for me over what has been, I guess, nearly 20 years as an educator. But I read an article just the other day that made this statement that the education industry spends upwards of $18 billion on professional learning, and some studies show that as much as 70% or more of educators are dissatisfied with the professional learning that they're getting. That's an awful lot of money, and it's an awful lot of dissatisfaction on both sides of that equation. When I think back to how professional learning used to be for me when I first began as an educator, it was very often limited to district mandated training that was somehow tied to a district initiative. And whatever the current initiative was, that's what we went and we lined up to be trained. And very often you'd look around the room and you'd see teachers grading papers. And of course, this was before cell phones. So we weren't on our cell phones, or I promise we would have been on our cell phones, doing anything to try to break up the tediousness of that kind of training. And that is as important and necessary as that is. I'm really grateful that that's changed over the years, so that we're no longer dealing with training being limited to what someone says that I have to have, being trained when they think I need to be trained, and where I need to be trained. It's still a reality. I go to those kind of trainings all the time, and I think they're always going to be a necessity for that kind of thing. But thank goodness that's not the only option that's available for us now. We have PLCs on my campus, professional learning communities, that are designed to be, I think, something innovative among the faculty on my campus. But for the most part, they're data interpretation groups. We try and look at the testing data and understand how we should respond to it. And when we first came up with the name professional learning community, I really thought it was going to be a learning community. And it's never really emerged as that. And so I think when some authors talk about, rather than calling it a professional learning community, I've seen someone refer to it as a network learning community, where we flatten the walls, throw down the borders, tear the walls down, and the whole world becomes an option for connecting to people. And Lucy, you know that certainly I'm preaching to the choir as far as you're concerned here. From the standpoint of understanding the impact of being a globally connected educator. Let me give you a few examples. I started leading training for my faculty about 9 years ago in technology. Now, I taught English, but I was a designated technology trainer because I had an interest in it, and our district uses designated faculty members on each campus as a technology liaison, largely to interpret district technology initiatives. But we also get to train our faculty on what we believe that and what they tell us that they need to be trained on in order to integrate technology into the classroom. You mentioned SAMR a moment ago. I have never, or up until the last year or so, have never been to a district-initiated training where I learned about SAMR. I learned about SAMR on Twitter 3 years ago, and I began training my faculty on that concept of integrating technology in that kind of way and understanding how to integrate with that model. But I didn't learn it in a district training in an organized face-to-face way. I learned it from strangers that I'd never met face-to-face on Twitter by talking with them and listening to what they were, or reading what they were writing and listening to what they were saying. Same thing with something as simple as project-based learning. I have never been to a workshop in my district on project-based learning. I learned about that by reading blogs on Edutopia and reading about it at the Buck Institute for Learning, and learned that project-based learning is problem-based learning, it's challenge-based learning. Now that's all changed and turned around. But we started learning those things from each other online before we ever really learned them in a district way. So when we think about networking beyond the walls and beyond the borders, I think being globally connected is kind of a defining characteristic of this kind of learning network, realizing that we can learn anytime, anywhere, from anyone. And so that's the present. Julie Lindsay does a lot, with the idea of the flat world or the flat classroom. And I think that may be her phrase that I keep using. I need to give her credit for that. But to me, that's really kind of an influential thing. And I'm going to go ahead and if I can do it while I'm talking, I'm going to type a Twitter hashtag in the chat box here that you're probably familiar with. But the chat group is called What is School? It's probably one of the most global educational chats that I know of that originates, I want to say that the leader of it is actually from New Zealand, but he teaches in Indonesia. And it's a very eclectic group of teachers, and it's literally hundreds sometimes that are involved in that chat. And it's one of the most dynamic groups for learning about how other teachers teach and other teachers learn in other parts of the world. It's very Asian in its influence, but a lot of stateside people from here in America and even Europe are involved in the chat from time to time. And I really would encourage if your students are involved on Twitter, that's probably a chat that they ought to take a look at in terms of understanding how this idea of globalists really works. EdCamps, I think Julie's probably going to talk more about that in a few moments. I'm sorry, Julie, not Julie, Leanne. No, Julie, that's right. I'm sorry. You are going to talk about that. But I want to talk about EdCamps just briefly because I think that represents a whole new frontier for professional development. I had a conversation today with our district ITD director, and we were talking about EdCamps, and we did our first EdCamp in our school district last fall. Went over really, really well, and we're expecting to probably double or triple the attendance based on some early feedback we're getting for this year's. We've actually had to move it to a university setting from the high school setting where we had it last year. But we have managed to convince our district professional learning department to actually grant CPE hours for EdCamp. And we use something here called exchange time, which means each year during the year, we're supposed to get 12 hours of off-duty training that we trade for two holidays. And up until now, the district has decided what counted for those 12 hours. And they kind of mandated that. But they have now allowed us to request that our principal grant us that actual work credit for EdCamp, which is kind of revolutionary. And I don't know very many districts that are doing that, but that's a huge step forward. All they're asking is an artifact, something that we produce as evidence of what we learned and the fact that we were there. Not just simply registering and getting credit for being there, but there's going to be a simple, some sort of probably a Google form response that we do that indicates something that we learned and a short reflective piece. But that's a huge step forward for our district. And I think reflection, there are two things that I think are going to make a difference there. Reflection is one of them, being able to provide evidence that we've thought about what we learned and we've processed it. And I think curation is another concept. I'm going to type something here as well. It's a tool that I use. If I spell it right, if this, then that, basically it's a .com. But what that enables me to do, for example, with my Twitter account, I have it links to a spreadsheet in a way with algorithms that I can't begin to understand. So like something on Twitter, it automatically curates to that spreadsheet. And I get the date, I get the person who tweeted it, and I get a link back to that tweet. And I can go in later then and type, I've got a little coding system where just a simple column on the spreadsheet where I'll put a keyword next to that. And if it happens to be a tweet about project-based learning, then I'm gonna go and I'm gonna put PBL next to it so that I can sort that spreadsheet. And then it becomes a resource for going back later. When I get to ready to do a PBL unit and want to deal with training on that, I can go back to that spreadsheet and pull up the links from all the people that I might have monitored their tweets or liked their tweets along the way. And I've got a rich resource of information there. So if this, then that is, and there are other tools out there like that. This just happens to be one that I kind of learned about. But just kind of close off with this. We really work hard to teach our students to become autonomous, lifelong learners. And I think as teachers, we really can't do any less than that ourselves. And we have the technology, we have the opportunity to take control of our professional development and learn what we need to learn when we need to learn it, the same way that we tell our children, our students, that they should do that. And we really have to model that, and we become much better educators for it. I am 10 times more effective as a teacher because of the things that I've learned, largely from people, once again, that I have never met, but I am in regular contact with. And when I need help, I know exactly who to ask. And that's my connected learning network, and it is global in every respect of the word. Lucy, I'll hand it back to you.
Yeah, let's have a discussion about this. I think you've given us a lot to talk about. So in the chat, I've been kind of Google tracking and putting in links to things that will that piggyback on all this. And so I have some questions. Just the two that are popping into my mind right now is, I'm totally with you on how being a globally connected teacher has changed my practice. And in my story is similar. I want to say, how did this all start for me? 2005, 2006, 2007, somewhere around there, I worked at a school that was associated with a university. And at that time, Facebook was only open to people who had a university email address. So I had a University of Chicago email address, so I got on Facebook, so that was one. But then 2007, I was probably an early adopter of Twitter, and that changed my life. Got to know a lot of people. And then another component of that was at the ISTE conference, my friend Steve Hargadon started doing these EduBloggerCon meetups. And so I had this kind of core group of people that were exploring things. And Steve also started Classroom 2.0 about that time too. So it was a pretty active community in terms of exploring Web 2.0 technologies, which of course we don't use that term anymore. But that was kind of the root for me. And then what I would add to that is I was really lucky to become part of two fairly elite teacher communities, and not everybody needs to be part of these, but one was originally the Apple Distinguished Educator Program. That really opened my eyes. I was one of 50 teachers. And this is open right now too. If anybody's interested, the ADE applications are open for the class of 2017. But 12 years ago, I got this award. 50 people get it every 2 years, and you go to a summer institute and you're with other like-minded people. And that I think that was probably the initial thing that kind of blew me out of the water. Like, I was finally with people who thought like me, and probably who were better than I was in a lot of ways, and really inspired me to do better. And then I guess now that I think about it, now that then the kind of the technology, the Twitter, the Facebook, all that kind of layered on top of it. And then I also became a Google certified innovator, which is, it was a different name back then, and actually involved with Google stuff really early on before that program really started. And because of that, I felt like there was a world outside of my school. I taught in Chicago public schools in pretty, isolated areas, pretty tough schools. And didn't get to go to PD. Maybe if I was lucky, I got to go to, some hotel room for a literacy PD here and there, but most likely I had to pay for it. And then I started working at a really elite school where people did their own thing. And there was a lot of autonomy, and it was great, but there wasn't necessarily a feeling of collaboration. And so this kind of life saved me professionally, Harrison. So anyway, enough about me. How do we quantify this, Harrison? How do we legitimize it? Because it's awesome to see that your district is offering the Texas version of professional learning credits, or whatever you call them. That's a step in the right direction. But how do we make this more legitimate and get districts not to be so top down about their approach to PD?
I think we're going to have to be willing to admit that we have to show something, for the effort. We can't just participate in a Twitter chat and expect to get credit for it. But we do have, and I did notice that our professional learning department right now is doing a Twitter chat on our new state teacher evaluation system, and they're giving CPE credit for that. So if you can prove that you were in the chat and you participate in a reflection piece at the end of that, then they're giving you CPE credit for that. So I think as teachers, we're gonna have to be honest about reporting what we've done and being willing to, as you said, quantify it, to be willing to say, I'm okay giving evidence of this. And we've never, a lot of times we're not, even in face-to-face sessions, we're not asked to produce anything. We just go, and our attendance there is enough to give us credit for it. It's it does indicate a different level of learning, I think, if I'm actually asked to produce something that's proof that I didn't just sit in a chair. I really thought about it, I've processed it, and I've tried to apply it in my classroom. And we're going to have to accept that, I think, as a criterion for taking the credit.
Yeah, the other piece of this, too, was I'm thinking about, too, back when I got going with this when I was a young teacher, was also blogging, that reflection piece that you're talking about. Blogging was like the big thing back in 2005, 2006. I'm not sure if it is anymore. But the reason I got started with it was to document my own practice so that, because I was afraid I was going to forget what I was doing. I didn't necessarily do it for other people. I wasn't doing it to show off. And then kind of serendipitously, people started reading and following blogs. And that also added to this feeling of community amongst people. I don't blog as much as I used to. I wish I did. I'm not as inspired. I'm inspired, but I'm not like, maybe if I were in a school on a daily basis, it would be a different story. But I think that kind of ongoing reflection is really important. And I have a friend who used to be a principal in Portland, Oregon, Tim Lauer, and he had his teachers keep blogs as kind of a newsletter. They used a WordPress installation in his school. And he would build time into his faculty meetings for them to blog. So I think that's another option for people too, is like, what are those, you know, time and space seem to be issues in schools. You know, how do we work around these constraints that are there? And being creative with the solutions is also really key, I think, to designing effective professional development.
Yeah. I think Julie's probably going to cover some of this herself, but I became an online curriculum designer, got certified to do that this year with my district so that I could use our learning management system. We use Canvas in my classroom so that I could develop online training for my faculty. I've been lobbying for that for years, and finally they developed a training course that they were comfortable with. Basically, you know, saying if you're going to do online training, it has to meet these qualifications. And so I took that course and developed my first online class that my faculty is taking right now. And because they're using our learning management system, they can work on that in their pajamas if they want to, you know, sitting on their back porch.
Well, I didn't realize. So this week and next week, I guess, the teachers are in my class are exploring online opportunities, and I was looking around at different options. We looked at Coursera. There's an innovation course running in edX right now that I think is particularly interesting. And the previous instructor of this, I'm using his shell for the course, and he had pointed towards Canvas, and I didn't realize that Canvas had some existing free open courses for teachers as well. I'm guessing that Participate also does. So Julie will probably talk about that as well. Kelly is asking here, I have another question too that I'd love to address, and Kelly has a question as well. I think for the people in my class who are listening to this now and afterwards, what are some of the elements do you think that it's important for designing PD events? I think that's something that I'd like to cover. And then Kelly would like to know more about what your training course looks like and what it's about.
Okay. The training course that I did was ironically an introduction to Canvas so that the teachers who were not comfortable using Canvas as an LMS in their classroom could learn to use some of its features. So it's designed around an orientation to the Canvas learning management system, but they're actually having to produce artifacts in it that would reflect, yes, I looked at how to create a quiz, and here's a sample quiz that I would create and use with my students. And so they're producing artifacts that demonstrate that they have actually tried to use some of the features of Canvas. And so it's basically a Canvas 101 course designed to help them get a leg up and start using it. Would you go back and ask the first part of that question again? Because I got lost part of that. I think the part that you wanted.
Yeah. So I think what are the elements of effective PD design? And I think this could be divvied up into face-to-face kinds of experiences and also online experiences. And, you know, teaching this this online course for me has been an eye-opening. I think that there's, it's not easy. I think it's harder to teach online in some ways because you have to develop a community without actually meeting and things like that. And you have to design experiences that are meaningful. And I think, you know, if I were going to do this over again, I would probably take a course before I taught online. I didn't realize that there was more of an art to it than I anticipated. And by the way, you know, Kelly and Matthew and Irene, if you ever do want to do online PD or adjunct work like this, there is an organization called iNACL that does specialize in this. And I haven't delved into it too much. I'll put the link in the chat. But that's their specialty is this kind of online space. So anyway, my main question is for online and for face-to-face PD, what are some things that we need to look for when designing experiences?
I think, you know, with online, principals like NACL would advocate really specific in terms of clear objectives, very well thought through objectives, and then strategies that allow the user end user to actually feel like they've accomplished those objectives, that they're really connected to each other, not just an arbitrary activity that we kind of throw in there, but it really is a direct connection to the objective itself. I think that's one key. As far as face-to-face PD, you know, transparency is awfully important for a presenter, I think, for a leader. That's where your experience is going to come in. That being very real and willing to be open and talk about the things that have worked and the things that haven't worked, and maybe some of the struggles that you went through, the iterations, the failures and redesigns that went into that. Hands-on learning, I think, while some things might lend itself to being more conceptual or philosophical and you're just going to talk and you're going to give them some content to think about, there's a place for that. But most teachers want to leave feeling they've actually gotten to try something. And face-to-face sessions allow them to do that if you can build that in so that they actually get to do what you're teaching them how to do, and they do it in an environment where they have a chance to try it and fail and learn something from that experience. Lucy, check your microphone.
I think that's the hardest part as somebody who does PD on a regular basis is thinking about the hands-on piece and how you can design something that's fairly simple without overwhelming the workshop and taking up too much time. I think there's an art to that. And I haven't mastered it. I'm getting better at it, but I wish there was a resource out there for, like, and maybe Julie will know something, you know, icebreakers and activities that build community when you're doing face-to-face or online stuff, or, you know, like kind of like a little cheat sheet of fun stuff to do to kind of build things up, or, a list of activities like, you know, pair and share or whatever that will get groups moving. I would really love, like, I have never found anything that I found to be like the ultimate PD resource for designing things. I need ideas from other people. I don't necessarily come up with them on my own. The other piece of this too, I'm thinking, just piggybacking on this and kind of answering my own question a little bit. I do some work with a guy named Don Buckley, who used to be a tech director in New York City. And we're doing a global workshop for a private school in Las Vegas in a couple weeks. And we just met with their lower school head today, and he came up, Don. So what we're going to do with this is, you know, the end activity is going to be the teachers have to come up with some sort of globally connected experience to use in their classrooms, and they can do whatever they, you know, whatever feels right. This school is unbelievable. They have the week of President's Weekend, they have that Monday off, but the next 4 days are devoted to professional development. So one day is kind of, they're doing diversity training type of stuff. The second day, and kind of community building. The second day, they're working on UBD units that they're developing. And then the third day they're working with Don and myself to kind of think about the how to incorporate a global perspective into what they're doing. And then the fifth day is independent work day. So they actually have time to work, and there's no school for the kids that week, which I thought was pretty mind-boggling. I've never seen a school really commit to professional development in that way. Anyway, during the course of this, Don is a big design thinking person, and I see that as a secret sauce to getting people invested in things, and that's why I like working with him. He's much better at it than I am. I feel like I learned through these workshops through him, and he suggested today this game called Disruptus that we're going to use. We're going to use some sort of activity from this game at the beginning to get teachers kind of innovating and hands-on. And I wanted to throw this out here because I thought it was really cool. And I will see how it goes. I'll let you know in a couple of weeks. I put the link in the chat, but we're going to use this game as an activity from this is kind of the opening for the workshop to get everybody in the mindset to learn and co-create together. So anyway, Julie, you want to jump in?
I was just going to jump in that Liz, who used to be at Convergence, who we knew there, is now with us in Chapel Hill at Participate, and she really uses design-based learning in all of PD. So that is a pretty well-established sort of model of bringing people through this like ideation to prototyping and just making stuff. And I think it's very content agnostic. And it always starts with some sort of warm up, takes like 5 minutes, and it gets people just moving. And even can be as basic as like, describe the most important learning experience, describe the worst learning experience, you know, just getting people to sort of share whatever seems relevant in that learning context. And then bring them together into these brainstorming sessions and then into making sessions throughout the rest of the PD day. But the design sort of principles are perfect for PD, I think.
Yeah. I saw Liz do a PD for the Convergence Academies, 2 years ago, I guess it was. And it was really well done. And it was simple. Like, I think there's also a tendency in a lot of professional development to overthink and overdo. And simple is better. And I tend to be an overwhelming force. I tend to be a fire hose. And so people leave my sessions with a lot of stuff. And I'm glad for them to have, because I want them to go back and dive into that stuff further. But I also think at the same time, I need to learn to prune. And it doesn't have to be some big production all the time either. And I think teachers are really happy. Very often in schools, people don't have time to collaborate.
I was just going to say that.
And so building that in there is huge.
And one of the things that we can do with online learning, that fire hose effect that you're talking about, we can actually build into our online learning forced periods of reflection. Brain science is telling us, that it doesn't do a lot of good to try and learn too much too fast. And we can slow that process down by structuring the online course so that they actually can't submit their response until they've had time to think about it a little bit. And of course, there's the assumption that they're really going to think about it, but just restricting their ability to post and submit responses isn't going to do that. But I think we can build that time in and slow the process down a little bit. There's something else that you said that kind of made me think too, something I'm experimenting a little bit with myself here about some things that I can do in my face-to-face sessions. I think getting students involved in our professional learning as teachers is kind of an important idea. I brought my 12-year-old grandson to a training 2 weeks ago, and he was my co-host. He was my co-presenter for the first 10 or 15 minutes, because I was teaching about inquiry-based learning and design thinking. And he and I had had a conversation about how he learned best in class. And he made the observation that the classes that he liked the most were the ones where he had opportunities to do independent learning and exploration. And I said, well, what do you like the least? And he said, the teachers who talk for 30 minutes and then give me a worksheet to take a quiz on. Well, we've all been there. So getting him in front of the teacher, I said, would you like to have a chance to tell teachers that? And he said, oh, that would be sweet. So he thoroughly enjoyed the opportunity to talk to teachers about that. In 2 weeks, I'll be at a private school conference where I'm doing what they're calling a fishbowl session, where the first 45 minutes, I'm teaching a group of students about SAMR or using the SAMR model to teach them technology. And then the second 45 minutes, the teachers who were there watching me teach the students, then we get to dialogue about what happened. But getting the students into the whole process, I think, is a great concept. And I think it's going to bring an element to our training that has been absent. And we're going to have to be very real in front of those students, too.
I think that's a really good point for my students. Take notes, everybody. this makes me think about, so Don, the guy that I mentioned before, and I worked with an international school in New York City 2 years ago to help them develop a culture of innovation. And it was an awesome project and a great opportunity. It's rare that a consultant like myself gets to do something like this. And what we did was, over the course of actually a little bit more than a year, you know, I did an assessment of the school and their readiness to innovate in some of the areas that needed to be kind of boosted in order to be as productive as they could. We did some design thinking workshops with the teachers to get them more agile in their thinking and for them to kind of understand what the process of design thinking is so that they could apply it to the complex problems that were facing the school. The school had, you know, a lot of New York schools are really, you know, dealing with space and time issues because New York City is, you know, everything is so compact. And these teachers were working their butts off and really needed time to collaborate too. So the design thinking helped with that. And then every month I was there for a couple of days doing kind of PD around their iPad program, which needed some work. And Don would take them to different places would take their leadership team and technology committee members to different places around New York City to see what innovation looked like. And a lot of schools also, this is another thing that I've discovered, is that a lot of schools are not letting people out of their district to see what's going on in other places. So another form of PD is being able to, even going on a site visit is really important. I would build some reflection or discussion or debriefing into that site visit activity. But this, I think this helped the school prime them to be able to do things on their own. In terms of the design thinking workshops we did, one of them was on homework. And this is where the student piece comes in. And we wanted teachers to think about, you know, maybe homework doesn't have to be, you know, 3 hours of reading every night or, you know, something that was kind of traditional. And we, Don kind of went over the design thinking process and showed what innovation looked like and that sort of thing. And I think from what I remember, I vaguely remember, but we had a panel of students as you know, part of the design thinking process is doing research in that time and space. So research could be interviewing people through Twitter or Skype, it could be looking at websites, it could be looking at real research, it could be whatever. And it could also be interviews with people who give you feedback and that sort of thing. So we had a panel of students who talked about their feelings about homework and what was effective and what wasn't. And then those teachers listened to it and then they developed some ideas and prototypes for what they wanted to do to change homework up in the school and make it more effective. And so that might be something. Another thing that my students may want to think about too is, you know, in terms of incorporating students, we don't ask kids for feedback. I think as teachers, we're nervous about feedback and using it. We take it really personally because teaching is such a personal thing. And then two, I think we don't value what kids have to say sometimes. I'm also seeing a trend. I just visited a friend at a school in Los Angeles where every semester the kids are evaluating the teachers. And that's really scary. And that school in New York that I worked with also does that too. And I'm not sure if I'm ready for that if I were in a school. But that's something that I think is a growing trend. Students, do you have anything else you want to add? We have some great resources in the chat. I'm really excited about this. John Spencer, he's a Texas educator, right, Harrison?
No, I want to say Colorado.
Oh, okay.
Colorado, but I'd have to double check that to be sure.
Okay, but you really recommend this book. Okay, so we'll take a look at that for sure. Anything else? Any students want to ask a question? Get on the mic or the video and and ask anything, or do you want, are we ready to kind of transition over to Julie? Everybody's quiet. You're good, Kelly. No questions. Okay. Do you want to wrap up, Harrison, by telling us what you're doing at TCEA and what they're about a little bit? Because we talked a little bit in the chat about it being an ISTE affiliate, but it's really a huge professional development organization in Texas. You want to talk a little bit about what they do beyond the conference as well?
Sure. TCEA has a continuing program throughout the year of webinars and online learning opportunities that we can take advantage of as members. We get support in the region where I live from regional directors that are part of TCEA. In our case, our regional director is a staff member at the University of Texas in Arlington. And so we get a lot of support, both directly face-to-face as well as ongoing training. There's a lot of advocacy that goes on, I think, behind the scenes that ordinary teachers just aren't that aware of, but they're constantly advocating for solid education at the legislative level and the governmental level here in Texas. The conference this week includes a real wide variety of the types of conferences, the lengths of conferences. I did a presentation today or a session, a one-hour session on gamification in my technology applications classroom. And we talked a lot about the role that gamification is beginning to play in education. Tomorrow morning, I'm leading a workshop, a three-hour workshop on challenge-based learning. And we're bringing a lot of fun tech tools into that to get the people, get the participants very hands-on with problem solving and creating a challenge for them that's got a really big picture idea.
Could you tell us, like, really, you know, you don't have to give your whole workshop or presentation, but the gamification thing may be new to some of my students. And what do you mean by gamification? And then challenge-based learning, I know what that is. It's a particular model of PBL. And maybe you want to elaborate on that a little bit for their background knowledge.
Okay. The gamification, the simple definition of gamification usually involves saying that you're taking the elements of gaming and applying them to your curriculum or content area. In my case, that includes badges, points, levels, multiple iterations, losing points for various activities and performance-related things. I try to incorporate elements in my class. The game shell that we've built around my course incorporates their academic work, their what I call character education, that involves community service and just their overall growth as a human being and how they live that out. Going to a tutoring session earns them points. Going to a detention hall experience, they lose points. They learn to work together as teams and as well as individuals. And it really doesn't have much to do with their grade that goes in the report card. It's kind of the opposite effect. The grade that goes in the report card affects the game points for them, but the game has no effect whatsoever on the actual grade that they receive. The challenge-based learning, you're exactly right, whether it's problem-based learning or project-based learning, challenge-based learning has a little different origin from project-based learning, but essentially what we're talking about here is using those critical thinking skills to deal with, in the case of challenge-based learning, it's supposed to incorporate a very large global size problem or challenge that has multiple possible solutions. The model that I'm using in the workshop tomorrow is a little more like problem-based learning, where they have a problem, it's very specific, and there really is only one great answer to it. They're going to have to get to that place through research. They're going to have to solve some mysteries, which is the creative side of it. I'm bringing Breakout EDU into that. If you're not familiar with that, it's a puzzle game, basically. And I've even brought in robotics because I'm bringing my Lego robotics in, and they're going to have to build a robot and program it in order to ultimately to solve the problem.
that's really useful information. A lot of people in the chat are also talking about Michael Matera and Explore Like a Pirate. He's a teacher at University School of Milwaukee, which, by the way, Illinois people, University School of Milwaukee does a summer conference, and Mike is a teacher there. I've presented at it a couple times. It's small. They also had the Dave, what's his face, who's the original pirate guy there as well last year, the summer before. So if you're looking for something that's local, that's high quality, that's not a ton of money to go to, look up the University of Milwaukee summer something. I can't remember what the name of it is, but Mike works there. He's been Dave Burgess. Okay. Yeah. And, So Michael's a really thoughtful teacher. The other thing, I put the link to Breakout EDU, and then there was something else I was thinking about as well. Oh, gamification. I've recently come across Chrome Warrior from my friends with Q. I do a lot of work with Q in California. And one of their volunteers found Chrome Warrior, which is a company based out of Seattle. And you can devise your own challenges and that sort of thing and badging with it. And so we used it for the Global Education Conference this year, Harrison, and pretty well received. I mean, I felt like, you know, I'm tired of giving out certificates for that event. It's you know, it's cumbersome. I don't think it means anything particularly because it's not tied to a university credit or anything like that. But people really like that, you know, acknowledgement of participation. But it's always been kind of a passive participation, right? And we have like hundreds of sessions from previous conferences and, you know, 200 to 300 sessions every year of stuff that people can access later on. And I was thinking about how can we leverage this? How can we build community? How can we leverage the content we've already developed? And so we worked with Chrome Warrior to develop these challenges, and it worked really, really well. I loved how people used that platform. Chrome Warrior is about $20 per user. It's not a free product. But I think like for a school district, I think it would be like a really awesome platform to try and do this with. There are other badging things that we've tried. I also like BadgeList a lot. We've worked with them very closely too. We used to use them for badging. So that's another one to look at. But anyway, Julia, the woman from Chrome Warrior, is going to do another session with us in this series. And Matthew, I think high schoolers would. I mean, I think high schoolers are the tough nuts to crack, right? I mean, and sometimes, and Harrison, maybe you want to speak to kind of the needs of how do you reach high. I think this would be a good question for Matthew. What kinds of activities and things do you find that engage high schoolers? Do high schoolers really take to gamification? High school boys in particular. Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. The boys are the ones who primarily get into it. Now, the way that I structure my big class-based game, everybody participates at one level or another. But there's a core of students who really get a lot out of that, and they use it as an opportunity to really engage their own learning pattern. And those are the gamers anyway. And it's just a way of kind of connecting to something that's already a part of the culture that they're coming from. I think there's a growing number of girls who are getting into that. Just like with coding and computer science, we're seeing a real push in that direction, and that's really, really healthy. But the gaming thing works with a lot of boys. I think the key there is to find relevant ties to who they are and kind of where they come from. So that it kind of makes sense to them.
Good answer. I like that. I'm really enjoying this conversation, and I think I have a Julia at home here, and I keep on saying Julia. Julie is going to kind of piggyback on this and add a lot to the conversation. So keep on asking the questions in the chat, everyone. I'm going to turn this over to Julie. If you want to screen share or whatever you want to do, Julie, you know, take it away. This is really informal. And everyone keep sharing stuff in the chat, and we'll wrap up whenever Julie is ready. So go for it, Julie.
Okay. So I can't believe the serendipity of both of us talking on the same night, because What I've been working on now with Participate is essentially creating tools for everything you just discussed. And Participate's entire, literally you've touched on almost every aspect of what we're hoping that the platform does. And we're really starting to partner with folks like Canvas to see how we can, how tools within an open, a totally open platform that's really just built for teachers could be companions for LMS systems like Canvas. So Harrison and others, we are always looking for feedback, and a lot of the tools, again, are open and free to use. So I may kind of ask you to be kind of testers of different tools in the platform around PD authoring and using some of our course structure for ed camps. So so basically, please stop me at any point. I've been like, as you've been talking, I'm going to try, I just kind of rejiggered how I would walk through a little bit of what Participate has to offer based on what Harrison, you talked about. So I'm going to share my screen. So Lucy or anyone, if you're not seeing anything or you're still just seeing me, let me know.
Okay.
I'm going now. Okay.
You have to pick this. Yeah. But there you go.
Then,
yep.
Okay, so can you see it?
We see
it. Okay, so just want you to know, we'll get to collections. I know some of your students have used it, but I created a collection as you were talking of all of the resources that you have had in the chat. So every from the books and the IME call and all of this are in a collection, and I just added both you, Lucy, and Harrison as collaborators, and I'm happy to include the students if I have their email. And I can walk through, I know there's some familiarity with how collections work and Participate, but I created one just for tonight as you were talking. So I just copied and pasted all those links. So let's just, basically the platform again is open. Collections have almost over a million resources that are vetted by experts, that are added by teachers, that are driven by teachers. And that's an OER library. So we can sort of talk about that. In addition, we have Participate Chats, which essentially we have a little fire hose into Twitter, and we you can basically run your chats through the Participate platform, and we have a relationship with Twitter, and I'll show you all the sort of functionality of the chats that I think get it a little bit, Harrison, of what you were talking about with the spreadsheet tool, which sounds really cool, and I'd love to hear it, and I'm curious if you, when I show the chat feature, I'd love for you to investigate that and give us feedback, given that you're such an active Twitter user. And my background is in education technology. I used to work for the Center for Children and Technology, part of the Education Development Center in New York City, where I'm from originally, and moved to North Carolina. And so I've been looking at ed tech for longer. My hair is very gray up here for a really long time, pre-internet. And I think I've become a very strong teacher advocate. And unfortunately, what I have seen is exactly mirrors, Harrison, what you described, is just a sort of a deprofessionalization of teachers, that there's not a lot of respect for the expertise that they bring in the room. I've seen teachers do the same five workshops, literally the same five workshops. So ESL teachers go the same one every year that the district mandates. No one cares if they've done it before. No one is interested if they want to deepen their learning in some certain aspect. There's no differentiation whatsoever. So while we talk about differentiation and inquiry and project-based learning and student-led classrooms, in classrooms, and there's a lot of lip service to that, there's almost none of that in PD. So you're often lecturing about inquiry when you should be modeling what you want your students to be doing, as opposed to just lecturing about it. Just wanted to show this. So this was great. Harrison talked about what is school. So this is the chat feature on Participate. So we have several, hundreds and hundreds of chats that come into the platform, and you can join What is School right now. You can join from here. And then the best part of the Participate chat feature is that you can see past chats. And this is where you can view a transcript. So this is a way of, when you were asking, Lucy, about documenting what people do on these chats, this is where this can start to happen. So you can see the messages. It also helps to divide it into questions and answers. So sometimes if folks are new to Twitter chats, it can get a little overwhelming in the moment of knowing which question you're answering. So this will also document this. So this could be a transcript that you could share with your district. And I was thrilled, absolutely thrilled to hear that districts are starting to recognize this work, because this would be a way for you to show your participation. So we do now have districts on here that are starting their own chats, and this is a way for them to sort of catalog what folks are doing. In addition, you can see the participants on this chat and you can click into them. You can see whether they're a participate user, and this will go directly to their profile page, so you'll be able to connect with them and build out your PLN. So if that's, I would love, given that this was an Harrison, something that you had mentioned, checking out this sort of transcript, and then you can go back, you can share the transcript, as I mentioned before. In addition, you can take all of the resources that were shared in this Twitter chat, all get scooped up into a resource collection. So on this particular time in, you can see all of the resources that were shared during this chat. You can add them to your own collection. These are my collections. So any individual resource that was shared in that Twitter chat can be added to your own personal collection at any time. So it's a really, really cool feature. And just so I can show you again, you can see, if we just go back, the whole calendar of chats is available. And so you can pick and choose depending on what your particular area is. There's many, many, many active chats from global to language to literacy. So this gives you also a really nice calendar of all of the chats that are going on, and you can jump into anything from Africa Ed to K-12 online conference. It's really quite remarkable how many chats are now in here. So please check these out, join, and start to build your PLNs, because I have never seen a technology in all of my 25 years of looking at ed tech. Twitter has been the most really remarkable sort of teacher-driven space. And I agree, Harrison, I've met so many teachers where almost all of their learning is happening on Twitter. And so, again, we're really helping schools and districts start to recognize this. So the other key part, because I don't want to talk too long, I'd love to do some more Q&A. So Lucy, please just jump in if you want to ask anything at any time.
I just put a link to if you wanted to show the Chrome Web Store and where they find the extension for you. So if you're not a Chrome user, I highly recommend looking at Chrome, because you can add all sorts of functionality onto your browser, similar to Firefox, but better. And there's an extension for Participate. So it would be great to see that. The other piece of this too is I can't find the collection that you shared with me. It's not popping up in Participate for me. It might be,
I think it's in your notification. Yeah, I sent you sort of a notification, and then you can also just search for it.
Oh, okay. So what's it called again?
It's your course TIE575.
Okay. And I'll put it in.
Yeah, and then you should have received a notification. Either it'll be in your notification, like the little bell by your profile.
Yeah.
Up in the top.
Okay.
And then, so the next piece I wanted to sort of show is the courses. And again, there's some really good sort of free courses, and then there are courses that we have developed with our school partners. And there's also lots of districts now. We have about 10 sort of partners that are hosting their PD in our platform. So the difference, I think, between us and K-12 Canvas is, again, we're not an LMS. This is an open sort of content management system, and it's not white labeled. So while we have customized sort of places for folks to enter that are branded, so some districts will have their own sort of entryway into their own chats, we really want to build a community. We have 40,000 educators in here, and so this is a way for folks to find each other and not be just in their own space with their own district folks. So looking at one of the courses that we have just started is Designing PDM Participate. So again, this is free. You can author your own PD, offer it to teachers in your school. And this is something that is we'd love for you to check out. And I think this gets a little bit to what Lucy was talking about sort of good practices. And Liz helped develop this and gives really good pointers on best instructional practice for professional development. And that's all accessible. If you go into courses, there are available. This is because I have my admin view, but if you go into the marketplace, you can see a bunch of free courses that are available to you. And one of those is Designing Your Own PD. The other thing that I think really gets at another thing that Harrison talked about was, for PD for too long, we wouldn't really know, or district wouldn't really know, if the learning was meaningful for teachers. They would sign in, maybe they would do their taxes, maybe it was the best PD you ever experienced, but you'd never know. So we really developed sort of an action sequence that's really about what's that teacher learning. How does it sort of connect to their classroom practice? And then what's the evidence that students are really experiencing change as a result of that professional development? And that's been always the difficult thing of really connecting, again, what Harrison talked to, this massive investment in professional learning, and where is really helping or challenging students to really change in the classroom. And the biggest component of this action, of this sort of action, our theory of action, is reflection. So it was just wonderful to hear Harrison talk about that. Reflection is a huge part of professional learning, thinking about yourself as a teacher. And I really worked a lot with teachers around action research. And so that's a big part of a lot of the instructional design here, is really, what are you doing in your classroom? Is it working? Is it not working? And how are you sort of reflecting on those changes? And so this walks our teachers, when you come into the platform, about how do you get sort of active in your own PD? Because I think what we're finding with some challenges is that teachers have for so long been in these school systems, they're sometimes resistant to even this approach of taking more control over their own learning. And so sometimes it's really getting them to sort of change their focus, which is like, okay, we're not going to tell you how to be a teacher. We're going to also give you the tools, resources, access to experts, and access to peers, so that you really build your own, not only professional learning network, but professional sort of learning courses. And you sort of pick what you need, depending on your students, depending on your experience as a teacher, etc. So then, let's see, I'm going to keep going along. And actually, this is getting a little cut off, sorry. So let's talk about ed camps. And Lucy, I am not seeing, if you can help me with the chat, I'm not seeing that in my, let me see if I can see my focus here. If there's any questions, I'd love to. I can't see the chat right now in my sharing screen. So
if you click on, I don't know if you can do it while you're sharing. You may have to stop to see it. But there aren't any questions right now.
Okay.
Kelly mentioned something. It would be nice to have a board or area for each of the areas I'm specifically interested in. And I'm not sure what she's talking about, but my response to her was, you know, couldn't you create a collection? Let's say they're, you know, Kelly, you're interested in old, I think the idea of curation is something that's,
it is huge. Yes, it is absolutely key. So part of our professional learning now is really talking about this issue of curation, because there's so much access to OER and to resources all over the internet. And I will tell you, I don't know if your teachers are having this experience, but I am seeing it all over the place. States just stop buying textbooks. Now, this digital, the digital content transformation is good on one hand, but textbooks, while I never would promote teachers teaching to the textbook, it's understanding what textbooks are were really actually a framework. So now teachers are really driving a lot of the resources that are used in their own classroom. So understanding how to curate OER, sometimes you have to adapt things that are in this library or things that are in other libraries and really fit into your own learning context. So why don't, if the questions are around collections, I'll come back to the EdCamps. And I can sort of show the EdCamp course and how you can document if you are going to think about participating in an EdCamp. We have a shell that allows you to capture all of your learning in the EdCamp, and then you can produce as a batch. Oh. So that's something that you can show, and it has links to all of your reflections and all of the work that you collected during your EdCamp. Okay. So that was super exciting. We're really excited about that.
I wanted to add something about curation too.
Yeah.
I think the idea of like saving, like I spend time, like I'm sitting in front of the TV with my laptop. I spend time, like if I know I have something coming up where I need resources, I might sit there and browse and save stuff for later. And that idea of like when you come across something that's so amazing and you may not use it right away in your practice, but you know that you're going to want to come back to it, that's when you want to harvest it and put it into something like Participate. So that mentality of kind of like, if you don't let something pass you by, save it, I think is kind of important.
So if you start, so if you wanted to do sort of a new collection, for example, so let's say you're, what did folks teach? Kelly, what do you teach? Or Irene, Michael, Matthew,
Matthew's an art teacher.
Art teacher. So, I mean, there could be some art. Let's just even see what we have. I'll just save it sort of art practice. Art resources. And then it's going to basically take you in there, and then you are able in the collections to either add a resources from the internet or upload a file. So this may be, you're right, Lucy, let's say you did a lesson plan and it was like you knocked it out of the park and you just want to, okay, I just want to hold it somewhere, not in my documents folder, not necessarily in Google Drive where I can't find anything, just right in this collection because I know I'm going to use it again. So you can also search resources here. So we can have Art High School. We can just look and see what some of the things that are available. And what you're going to start to see is, in this case, Viviana Henriquez already has a collection with 30 resources. So you can go and check out what Viviana has done. Right now, because she has let this to be open, you can subscribe to her. And so anytime that she adds more collections, you'll see it. Or you can add all of her resources to your collection. So I just created that collection. I'm going to add all of Viviana's to that. And so now I've started. In addition, what Lucy said, if you're just sort of watching TV and you're cruising around the internet, you'll be able to also capture those links and add those to the collection. So that's really how that sort of works.
And look at that, everybody, as a way of, there's so much stuff out there. And then if somebody like Viviana's already kind of vetted high quality stuff for you, that adds another dimension to your collections and that sort of thing. And so this kind of mentality of following people and seeing what they're bookmarking and that sort of thing started for me years ago with something called Delicious, which still exists but hasn't really been developed. Yahoo bought it a number of years ago. And then I evolved into something called Digo, and now I'm using Participate. But in all of those communities, it's been about like following certain thought leaders who I think are interesting, and I want to see what they're bookmarking, because if they're bookmarking certain things, then I know it's good and I know it's of interest and it's current. So that's another benefit to this social bookmarking or whatever you want to call it. I think it's really useful.
Yep. And the other thing that is a function that's really, really important to use is the sort of collaboration feature on the collections, because I think it's really, really unique. I'm just looking. You can still see my screen, right, Lucy? Yes. I'm still sharing, right?
No, you're not.
Sorry. Okay, hold on one second. Sorry. All right, sorry. Okay. Because this is a feature that I think, again, I just want to make sure. This was a collection that I created, so I don't know if there are global educators on here, but these are some of the older, this is our VIF before we became participate, but where we focused a lot on building resources for folks that were really becoming global educators and thinking about how to integrate sort of global content into the curriculum. So I created a collection of sort of expert created lessons. Now, if I wanted to invite you all to collaborate with me, so I would type you in. If you're a user, I can also just use email. I'll invite Lucy here. And then once Lucy comes in, Lucy and I would be able to sort of start having a conversation back and forth. And we're actually using a lot of these tools now to do peer review. So that's another, we're working closely with Partnership for 21st Century Skills. And we built, they put some of their courses in there, and we built in peer review into their courses. And so this kind of feature of being able to talk about it. So the, not only that curation of building on other expert curators in our system, but being able to talk to them. And this is another thing that can be used for a grade level team. So if you're working with your grade level and you want to build a unit or you're doing some planning, we're starting to see grade level teams just use this. So they're adding resources, adding links. Oh, check this out. Oh, I'm going to use this for my math lesson. Oh, I don't know if it's any good. So having that conversation and really using this space as a way to collaborate. During meetings, sometimes in face-to-face settings. So I think, yeah, actively, it would be great to see if folks started to really use this, and please, you know, start a collection, invite me. I'm happy to put my email in the chat, and we can really start to work together even after this, this evening is over. Yeah.
I just saw one other thing that, you know, this is going back to the Twitter chats for a second.
Yeah.
So in all transparency, I've been doing a little bit of work for Participate Learning and connecting their Chicago area guy to various school districts. He's been interested in meeting, you know, getting feedback from you know, tech directors and that sort of thing. So if you have a tech director and you want him to meet with Brad, I'm more than happy to connect you. But the other piece, what I think Brad has been particularly interested in, is that districts are using hashtags to initiate conversation amongst all their stakeholders. And the chat piece, I forgot about this. I know this is kind of after the fact, but so you can go in there and see what a school district has, you know, what kind of conversations they've been having on Twitter. Some school districts do their own Twitter chats.
Yeah. So this
is one that you know about?
Yeah, this is Wake County Public School System here in North Carolina. So this is the, you can join, you know, so it, your school district can absolutely, there are tons of them. And so this is, you can view the transcript. You can see the upcoming schedule. If we look at a past chat that was done last week, this was a shorter one. There have just this one, but there are some chats that the Wake County has used a ton. We can use, you know, let's do one that's been, was active. So this is an example of the Wake County, how the Wake County's used it. They have their moderators, questions and answers. And then they are able to see, okay, well, how did Mrs. G sort of do this answer? What, you know, this is a way that in terms of how do you document what is called informal, I mean, is this is a perfectly good way where you can share, if you've been active in this chat, you would be able to share this with your principal. Again, you can see all the participants, and again, you can view the full resource collection that was shared during this chat. So this would be, I mean, districts are really starting to really use these actively. So that's very exciting.
Is the extension for adding stuff to a collection, is it still in the Chrome Web Store? I'm looking right there.
Yeah, I'll have to get back to you. I'll send that information to you, Lucy. I think they're making some tweaks to that little snippet tool, so I will find out what's going on. But yeah, that was a little handy thing. So I'm not seeing that right now. Because I did have it. Yeah. I'll find out. I'll check with
it still works for me, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a way to sort of snap it. Yeah.
So Irene, theoretically, if you see in Julie's toolbar up to the right of the address bar, you see where it says PL. That's where the extension goes, and you click on it, and then you can harvest stuff as you're surfing the web. You still have to go back into participate and move it into a collection. Mm-hmm. It'll be in your bookmarks. That's how it's supposed to work.
Yeah.
But either way,
it's just a simple, you know, either that or when you're like, so the way that I added resources from our conversation was just copying and pasting the link.
Okay.
And literally if I go and just use any of these pages, I could even, you know, use this and add this collection. You just literally do that and then add it.
Okay. All right. Are you guys ready? Let's see what they're doing with EdCamp. I think we're ready for the EdCamp stuff.
So the EdCamp piece, again, how many folks are familiar with EdCamps? Have you ever been to one or?
I think Kelly is probably the only person.
Kelly, could you tell me a little bit about your EdCamp experience? If you don't want to, that's okay too. But I'm just curious about whether it was recognized by your district or if you were able to, get sort of credit for it, or was it just something that you did and it was just meaningful for that?
She's muted, but she may have a TV on or something like that. So.
Oh, okay. I'll just go on so the EdCamps, we are helping EdCamp essentially, do both use their hashtag. So exactly the way that participate chats works, you use a hashtag for an EdCamp. So the idea is if educators come, they self-organize. So this is a great picture of one. It is basically an unconference. So they sort of think about, okay, themes, when are they going to be met, and then who's going. And you sort of run around and talk to each other and basically drive the PD yourself with a group of so I've seen it where groups of teachers run it themselves, or maybe they'll bring in an expert. Let's say bring in an expert about STEM, and they will do different topics. So again, the issue that, and Harrison brought this up earlier, is that sometimes these are temporal activities. You don't necessarily capture your learning, and you don't necessarily have that as an ability for districts to say, okay, that is professional learning. Okay, instead of the workshop that was mandated last year, an ed camp, let's say you're a math teacher, if you're doing some sessions around fractions, that counts. So what this course is designed to do is walk you through. Basically, it's just a shell. It allows you to capture your learning in the EdCamp. It allows you to, then you have to reflect on that learning. How are you thinking you might apply this in your own teaching, or if you're teaching other teachers, how might you apply that? And then once you're through the course, then you get a badge. So I can sort of show that sort of course structure. So if you look at the course that we created for this, it's a very similar structure. So at each point, you're going to have checkpoints, you know, creating, joining discussions, creating collections. This is exactly how the EdCamp course is structured. Then you're going to reflect on this, these experiences, and then you're going to use what you've learned. And essentially all throughout, you're creating a collection. And then in the end, you're going to submit your work for a badge. And basically you're submitting your collection. So as you're going through the EdCamp, you're building a collection based on, can be pictures, can be conversations, can be links, can be your reflections, and then you're going to submit it. So this is going to be a link to the collection. You're going to write a reflection. You're going to save and you're going to finish. And it's going to walk you through that whole process. And then in the end, you will earn a badge. And those badges are up here. These badges are here in your badge portfolio. And essentially, they will show up here, and it'll show the criteria. And then this is a way for you to share this. You can edit your badge, and you can send it on to your whoever sort of signs off on professional learning at your school or your district.
So
that sort of does that answer the question?
Yeah, so here's this is totally awesome. Here's my question. So for the students in my class, which is all of you, except for Julie at this point, the Mozilla Foundation, the people behind Firefox, started an open badging platform called the Mozilla Backpack. And there's been coalitions of people working on how to develop badges to recognize informal learning and that sort of thing. And so my question for Julie is, are these exportable to your Mozilla Backpack? Does the Mozilla Backpack thing still exist? I'm not up on the latest and greatest with badging.
Yeah, I mean, we're sort of working with the badge community. I mean, this is probably going to be a big conversation at ISTE. We are still, everyone is still sort of complying with the open metadata. But I think IMS Global is sort of taking over some of that piece. But for those of us that have been working in open badging, ours are completely open. They can be shared. They can be posted to Facebook and LinkedIn and Twitter. They can be, again, we're working with Canvas so that our badges can move into Canvas if your profile is in Canvas, so that we're making sure that information sort of moves back and forth and is always attached to the learner. So you always control that portfolio. So that's the answer to that. Mozilla is no longer doing it, but there's another consortium that's sort of taking it on.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And so just making sure that, just making sure that that folks are still creating badges that are open and shareable. I mean, that's the most important thing. They have to be portable. And I think the thing, just looking at some of the questions about would everything have to be in one collection? It doesn't necessarily have to be in one collection. I think if you created one collection around any EdCamp, even if it was really diverse. So I like what you're saying, like at EdCamp, you're sort of going to things, different things that are kind of interesting to you. You might leave a room, you might go to another room. You know, you probably would have one collection for that EdCamp. It's like, this is the most meaningful stuff, and this is why. And that I think is like, once you can show that sort of reflection and that sort of curated collection of that EdCamp experience, I think hopefully we can start working with districts to really recognize this instead of something that's mandated and not particularly meaningful to you. I hope that question.
Yeah, it's interesting, like to see the progression in all of this. Like, you know, 10 years ago, this was really not recognized by districts, and now you have districts who are trailblazing. And I'm trying to think of the ones around us in here in Illinois that are doing interesting things that you guys might want to keep an eye on.
Yeah.
Just out of curiosity, like I think 109, which is Deerfield, has a superintendent who's very social media savvy, and they seem to be doing a lot, and they have a hashtag that they use. I don't know what it is off the top of my head. I've been a couple site visits lately that I think are doing really interesting things with PD and that sort of thing too. Fairly large districts that have a lot of resources. One is District 59, which is, we have a person in our course who's a teacher in that district, Lori. They're really interesting. I love my site visit there. And then Barrington School District, which is a K-12 district, really interesting. You know, they're doing a lot of stuff with iPads and that sort of thing too. I'm not sure about professional development, but now I'm thinking ahead. The other one that kind of struck me, I'm working with a small district in the North Shore to help them become more innovative. And so I've been looking for tons of examples to show them of schools that are doing interesting things. And one that, Julia, you may be interested in is Gurnee Public Schools. They're a one-to-one iPad program, and they have like this, they have like a kind of a challenge oriented PD program. And it's like, it's something to do with like going around the world or a map or something. And they've tried to make it a little bit more innovative. And I think I introduced Brad to their tech director. So it'll be interesting to see, you know, if they're able to marry what they've been doing to exist, to stuff with you guys as well. But I think, you know, Matt, so just to give you background on my students here, Matt is working at a boys Catholic school near Hyde Park.
Mm-hmm.
And so Matt, you know, I'm thinking like schools that might be doing interesting things that would be comparable to you would be like Loyola up in Wilmette. They're a one-to-one iPad school. They're an Apple Distinguished School. That might be one. I think St. Ignatius also does some interesting things with technology. They might be a one-to-one iPad school as well. I don't know anything about Fenwick at all in terms of what they're doing, but the two, Loyola is the one that sticks out to me because I know that they're an Apple Distinguished School, which means that they've gone through a vetting process through Apple. I know Fenwick's a great school in general. So the, Fenwick is in River Forest, right, or Oak Park. And I'm trying to think, the public schools out in that area might be kind of interesting. In River Forest, I know some people who work there. Go ahead, Julie.
No, I was just going to say, I was looking at a couple of the questions in here. So, Lucy, I don't think I answered you in terms of who approves the badge.
Oh, yeah.
Because this is an interesting question. So there's many different sort of ways that we originally when participate some years ago, we were part of the original sort of open badge competition. And what we initially did was we worked with districts essentially to just, if the teacher went through our course, they did all of the steps and they collaborated with peers and they reflected on their learning, they got the badge. Increasingly, districts were like, well, who approves that? And it was like, well, you right now, the bar is pretty low on PD. So as we mentioned before, you had PD where people just did sign-in sheets. And like I said, like I usually will say, well, like eat a bag of Doritos. And that was your evidence that there was PD. So in some ways, we were really pushing back to the district saying, okay, the badges have links to what teachers did. And so you can always see, it's always transparent. So the districts became our partners in terms of approving what that PD was. But one thing I'll, P21, I think I mentioned the peer review. So we built that into their course, and Dave Ross, who used to be at Buck, is now running P21, asked us to sort of build in peer review. So if you can all access this sort of marketplace of PD in courses. When you go in the dashboard, you can just go into courses and then there's some free stuff. So in terms of the participating in EdCamp, that EdCamp course is free for you to use. So if you, your next EdCamp, please try it out and give us feedback. Okay. And that's all available to you under the courses tab. You also have access to designing PD. So Lucy, this may be great if there's an assignment where you want them to design, if your students are designing a professional learning or we'll walk you through. We have course authoring tool, content authoring tools in Participate, and you can build your own course.
That might be this.
So these two things are.
This could be an option. This could be an option. So they're going to do a benchmark project, which I have.
Great.
Because there's accreditation things. It's a long story.
Okay. Any way we can help. I mean, if you guys want to help me test it and see if this would fit for this assignment.
Yeah.
This might be
the platform that they could use for that.
I would love it.
I think so.
Any issues that you have, you know, Lucy, I'm happy to come back and, you know, we can do anything you need after you check it out. One thing I was just going to show you with the P21 in terms of how badges are sort of assessed is we do work with partners where they want that peer review in. So here's a teacher that worked on the P21 courses. And so she had her course in there. You can see her sort of, that's a test. So she reflected, did a bunch of reflections on some of the P21 videos and other research brief. I mean, Dave Ross really built a pretty meaty course. And then essentially they have you join the discussion. Her peer reviewer, which isn't available to me, but to her peer reviewer, you can leave comments for her. You submit them. And then depending on how those discussions go, then you award the badge. So she was awarded the badge based on the work that she submitted here. But this is an example of how different types of peer review tools that are now in the platform.
Okay. That looks fabulous.
It's good.
This is perfect. Everything that we've been doing the past couple webinars is leading up to their benchmark project. And I'm thrilled that, you know, 3 out of my 10 students joined us tonight, and hopefully more people will watch this after.
Yeah. Yeah, that's great.
The other person, so Kelly's a fourth grade teacher, and she's kind of experienced with some of the things that we've talked about. But the person I'd like you to address a little bit more is Irene, who is, and you know, she might want to tell you in the chat what she does exactly, but she has a global awareness company that does professional development with schools and workshops with kids. Around stuff, and so she's not, and when she and I have had discussions about, you know, the global education world in general. So if you want to, I don't know, anything that might help her kind of,
yeah,
think about multiculturalism and that sort of thing, that would be appreciated.
Yeah, I mean, so you know, a lot of our heart is in with global education, and I think the way that we see the platform is a way of really driving certainly how we see global education and why we work so closely with Lucy, really like minds about connecting every classroom to the world around them. To me, it's about relevance, authentic learning. So it's not necessarily about, you know, memorizing the capitals of the world, right? It's just about problem-based learning. How do you kind of create context around learning? So even though I'd been involved in ed tech for most of my career, really the last 5 years, I've been really focused in on global education. And it's been really remarkable to see how teachers have used global education to build multidisciplinary units, right? Concept-based teaching, PBI. It was like, it was the vehicle to do all of these things that we had been talking about for many decades. And it just became a much easier way of sort of talking about, look, you can connect all the dots here. Design-based learning, challenge-based learning, problem-based learning, you know, teachers were getting stuff thrown at them left and right. And global was really a very easy way. It's like, okay, just let's look at water around the world. We can build in STEM here. We can build in culturally responsive teaching here. So I think there's just so many opportunities with global. So if you can still see my screen, we just actually rebuilt one of our courses. We have an extensive course offering for global teachers. We have over 60 courses that run the gamut from, and I can take you through those courses, but one of them that I really love right now is around culturally responsive teaching, and it's one of our core modules that we have our global schools start with. So it's really about how to develop that critical cultural lens in teachers and also in kids, but it really begins with autobiography. Who are we? What defines us? What is sort of culture in that sort of autobiography? And then so it walks through teachers through, again, our same theory of action, but really sort of talking about, okay, let's build a collection around culturally responsive pedagogy. We have a lot of resources in here. We start with the teachers with, again, create your collection. Start thinking about curation. Right? We're going to talk about culturally responsive teaching in this course. Let's name the collection that. So we, even though we are big believers in informal PD, there is also a place for more structured learning. And this is the course that sort of helps provide that. Then we have investigative stages where we're going to focus on specific resources for the teachers. So we do the cultural iceberg activity. We give a lot of resources here that take them out of the platform, but that they are allowed, they can then build their collections. And then different ways to get to know your students. And creating kind of ways of doing cultural resumes in the classroom, and then building ultimately a basic lesson plan that integrates these concepts into your teaching, and then you actually teach it. So that's where the action research part comes in, is walk through sort of this culturally responsive teaching. You think about it in your own classroom, you build a lesson, you teach it. What worked? What didn't work? Did students learn anything? How do you know? And all of that is attached as evidence, and that's what earns you the badge. So I can go back to and obviously you could see that you can navigate here on the right-hand side. We use an inquiry framework for almost all of our courses that we develop. And so that you're asking questions, you're investigating, again, trying to model for teachers what we really hope they want to do with their kids. And I loved Harrison's idea of bringing kids into PD, some PD sessions. I think that's awesome. But let me show you in my courses, because I have, pretty extensive. So we have courses for secondary, teaching conceptually, social entrepreneurship, Intercultural competence inquiry, global interdependence, understanding students' global competence. So we segment that in 6-12 and K-5, and we're sort of playing with that. Then we talk about action research, and that is something that's very close to my heart. Teachers tend to want to kill me when I mention action research, but that's mostly because usually it's done in grad school, and we really try to reframe action research for the working teacher, which is like every day you're testing stuff. Every day, teachers are like, oh my God, that lesson bombed. It worked for these kids, but not for this kid. And that is where learning happens. Teacher, it's so critical. And unfortunately, teachers are too often in environments where they're not allowed to fail. And you cannot innovate without that culture of being able to fail without a punitive action. And unfortunately, too many of our schools really have that going on. And I think I'm seeing that got chipped away a little bit, that teachers can try out new stuff without fear. And that's been such a stumbling block over the last decade, in particular, last 15 years. So I'm really hoping that as schools and districts are playing around with ed camps and all of these new kind of professional learning opportunities for teachers, they'll also let teachers experiment. You can't experiment without stumbling around. It's just not possible. So this gives you, we also work a lot with dual language. So we run almost 60, more than 60 dual language programs here in North Carolina and Virginia. We're also starting to work in states outside of the Southeast to support dual language initiatives. And we really have a full sort of participate school model, which is global and dual language together, whole school models around doing kind of authentic, engaged learning, global learning in the classroom. And so, yeah, we have a lot. We also have a pretty extensive offering of stuff in Spanish. So we have many, many interdisciplinary units, both for K-5 and for 6-12 in Spanish. And those are designed for dual language classrooms and also for world language classrooms.
So have some of these courses come from your acquisition of New Global Citizens, or are they?
Yes, there's the New Global Citizens course. Yes. And that is also available. That should be free in the marketplace, and I don't see it right now, so I'm just going to check in on that, but that is also available for you guys.
So Irene, New Global Citizens was an after-school program sponsored by the Hewlett Foundation, based out of Arizona, and BIF, now Participate, acquired them and all their content, I don't know, a year ago or so. Mm-hmm. So it was a really interesting model. Mm-hmm. So you know when Julie, just add if you can add anything to the collection that you started for us.
Yeah,
that would be great. You were so fast with all these things. I can't find everything as quickly as you can. So if any of these units, if you can throw them in that collection, then we're in. Then we can follow up and look at all this stuff after the.
Yeah, I'm seeing, yes, and I'll definitely, I added, so Matthew, you had put your email in the chat, and I did send you, left here, let me see if I have your collection page up, I don't. I'll add that all, Lucy, to that TIE575. To your class thing, but certainly the courses, the global courses, I'm happy to sort of talk offline with anybody who's sort of interested in that. Those are available to our participate schools, and they are soon also going to be available in the marketplace, and some of those will be, and there is a new Global Citizens course that is accessible to all, and I'm not sure why it's not in the marketplace, so I'll make sure to add that to your collection. But okay. These are amazing, by the way. These are some global science lessons that were developed by New Global Citizens, and these are all available for middle and upper and high school. So for anybody in those grades. And I think mostly New Global Citizens was an after school, but they started, it was an after school program, really engaging high school kids in after school projects. And then they changed to working directly with teachers. So let me just show you that really quickly. And then I know we're, I'm just going to show you.
This has been fabulous because
I'd love for you guys to use all of this stuff. So you can see my screen, right?
Yeah, no, we can't.
Can you see it now?
No.
Okay, hold on a minute, sorry. I'll show this last thing, but if you do a search on New Global Citizens, yes, you can see it now. Okay. Yes.
Yeah.
It will bring up these pretty big units, these very big collections, 25 resources here. But these are actually math and science connections. So this is grade 6 science and one that's focused on stats.
What I like about the courses and the lessons that you have too, they serve as models of what effective course design looks like and what effective lesson design looks like too. So even if you don't necessarily use these are,
right.
You see how they've been set up and how they're designed and maybe that will influence how you do things as well.
Yeah. And we're hoping, and that maybe is just something to sort of dive around in when you're going through the platform. And again, I'm always here if there's follow-up questions. Basically, once you guys log in, this dashboard will be available to you, and then just start playing around. And anything that's just unclear or you can't find, just let me know. And you'll see again these notifications up in this corner. And that will tell you if you have notifications waiting, et cetera. So hopefully, Lucy, you'll see that in terms of the, and your students will see that. But yeah, send me emails and I'm happy to, add you guys and
okay.
Can keep working on it. And, we can communicate that way through that collection.
So the other thing I would recommend everybody is to follow Participate on Twitter, which I think is it just Participate is the Twitter handle?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I always like to follow companies and places I'm interested in on Facebook as well. So if you want to keep abreast of what's going on with Participate and that sort of thing, you may want to follow them on social media. The other thing is, I'm guessing Brad, who works for Participate and is here in Chicago, he probably will be at the ICE conference at the end of February, and maybe he can come join our, I think we're gonna try and get some of the NLU people together for lunch. So maybe he can come join us and chit chat with us and that sort of thing too. He's a really—
Oh, that would be great, yes. Okay, so Irene, I'm just inviting you. So this, it probably will also pop, if you don't have a set up an account, go ahead and do that. And then I can easily keep adding stuff to here.
I'm so excited. This has been serendipitous.
Yeah, I'm sorry. If I may ping Harrison, just I'm curious about— I'd love some feedback on that designing your own PD and the course authoring tools, and those are newly out of the newly minted.
We'll probably do a drop in session or something. As we're about halfway through the course, we're almost at halfway point, and so we need to start talking about this final benchmark project, and I need to really take a look at it and update it. So there probably will be another session where we might talk about what that might look like. But I think people like Irene and Kelly have been here for the first two sessions. I think they probably have gotten a gazillion ideas now of things they can incorporate. And I think this platform will make it a lot easier for them to deliver something without having to reinvent the wheel. So I'm excited to see what people come up with.
Oh, and by the way, I'll just one final answer. Sorry to Kelly, the dual language for teachers or students. Sorry about that. I didn't see it. So the dual language, so the things I was showing you, there's dual language PD, that's for teachers. So that is differentiating in a dual language classroom, balanced literacy for dual language, globalizing in a dual language classroom. The curriculum is for students. So those are, they're written, they're just curriculum units. And so there's activity sheets in there, resources for the teacher. So these are just pretty big curriculum units, but the PD is for teachers.
Okay.
For both, I guess.
Good to know. And is it by grade level?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Any other final questions for Julie, guys?
Yeah. Thanks for having me.
Oh, thank you. I mean, it's late where you are too. It's almost 10 o'clock. So I appreciate you doing that.
Oh yeah. No worries.
Anyway, I'm really, really appreciative of this. This has been great. I'm going to end the meeting and stop the recording, end the meeting. And it takes, I don't know, a few minutes for this to process, but I will have it up in my YouTube channel and I'll share it with you all too. And please, you know, direct other people to this, because I think this is incredibly valuable, the information that we've had in the past two webinars. And I couldn't do this without you. No.
Yeah, it was so fun.
So thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Julie. We really appreciate it. So have a good night, everyone. I'm going to just stop recording and then we can keep chatting. Thanks everyone for coming. I really appreciate it. Great to see you here, Matthew, Irene, and
yeah, nice to meet you all.